Hey guys, welcome back to an all-new weekend edition of the Chuckload of Comics Show, your source for the nerdy headlines of the week. Every single week right here on YouTube, Chuckload of Comics streams right here on the Chuckload of Comics YouTube channel, as well as the Mainframe Comic-Con YouTube channel. So wherever you're watching this show, please take a second, click the subscribe button, and join us here every single week for all the fun. What an amazing week in the world of geekdom.
Holy cow.
Wonder Woman. We got our first reviews of the new Wonder Woman 1984. The Twitter reactions are in, and we're going to be reading them for you. They are positive. They are glowing. They are gushing with goodness. And we're going to break that down right away. Also, Alfred Molina returning as Doc Ock in the new Spider-Man 3 film.
Holy cow.
That happened, and it just blew the socks off everybody in the world of nerddom. They thought, how could this week get any better? And then a rumor dropped that maybe Charlie Cox is going to be returning as Daredevil in Spider-Man 3 as well.
What?
It is a rumor, so don't go yelling at us saying that it's not confirmed. I know it's not confirmed, but it could be, and I'm going to explain why in just a minute. Alien, the Alien series is announced for the FX network, an Alien television series, and Marvel Comic is rolling out their first ever Alien comic book series.
Sweet.
So we're going to break down the television series and also what to expect in the comic when it comes out this March. And finally, Mandalorian Season 3 finally got a release date.
Yeah.
We're going to talk about our predictions for Season 3 and tell you when exactly Season 3 of Mandalorian is going to drop. So tons of nerd news to get into, guys. So buckle up, strap in, put on your helmets. This is this week's nerd news. All right, guys, first big nerd news story of the week, Wonder Woman. The first Twitter reactions are in for Wonder Woman 1984, and they are positively glowing.
Yes, I'm so happy.
Me too. It is being praised as an ambitious and heartfelt sequel. The official review embargo doesn't lift until December 15th. It just feels good to say the words review embargo because we haven't gotten a new movie in so long. That used to be something we said every single week, and it's been like 10 months since we've uttered the words review embargo. So I'm excited for Wonder Woman 2. The review embargo lifts December 15th, but the critics were allowed to screen it and give their Twitter reactions. We're going to read those Twitter reactions right now. Just a reminder, the film hits theaters and HBO Max on Christmas Day.
If your theaters are open.
If you have a theater open in your town, I highly recommend, based on these reactions, that you go see it in the movie theater. I'm hoping theaters open up in Chicago in time for Christmas Day, but I don't think they will.
Doesn't seem like it.
So I'll be streaming it on HBO Max. Unfortunately. So let's go ahead and get into some of these Twitter reactions. The first one comes from Mansoor Mithawala.
That's a mouthful.
I know. Sorry, Mansoor. Mansoor wrote, finally saw Wonder Woman 84. It's genuinely great with lots of big, exciting moments, yet it's all grounded in a personal story. Not only is it a solid sequel, but it's actually an excellent replacement for Superman, too. Huh? Plus, that's 2-T-O-O. Plus, there are some neat surprises. Interesting statement.
Wow.
But he did say it's genuinely great.
Yeah.
Lots of big, exciting moments. I don't understand exactly what he means by
the Superman.
An excellent replacement for Superman. Maybe just the character of Wonder Woman. Since we don't have any plans to see Superman on the big screen anytime soon. So she's just a really good replacement for
like,
the Superman
like you
character.
Said, I love the genuinely great.
Genuinely great with lots of big, exciting moments.
Nice.
And it's grounded in a personal story. So really, really cool. And next one comes from Terry Schwartz. Terry Schwartz writes, I was lucky enough to be among the first to finally get to screen Wonder Woman 1984. I adored it. The first Wonder Woman was my favorite of the modern DC films, and Wonder Woman 84 makes all the smart next steps, telling a very human and very beautiful story for Diana Prince.
Wow.
So that's very good.
Yeah.
She said that Wonder Woman was her all-time favorite of the modern DC era.
I have to agree.
Didn't say this one exceeds it, but she said they make some really smart next steps.
Perfect.
In the franchise, and that's all you want, because we know Patty Jenkins is going to finish up her trilogy, and then she's done.
Okay.
So it sounds like they're planning a 3-movie
amazing
arc, which is very smart. Something Star Wars should have done.
Right.
But we won't go off on that right now. Next,
JJ.
Next Twitter reaction comes from Jermaine Lucier, who writes, yesterday I saw Wonder Woman 1984 at home, and it was everything I needed and more. The movie is hugely ambitious, incredibly exciting, and full of much-needed hope. It's also very long to a fault at times, but mostly it reminded me how wonderful a big blockbuster can make you feel. So interesting little little jab there, Jermaine.
Huh.
He said it's really long, almost to a fault.
Wow.
At times, but I like what he said about reminding me how wonderful a big blockbuster can make you feel. Because we haven't gotten a big blockbuster, unless you count New Mutants.
Yeah.
Which I don't, because it wasn't a big blockbuster. It was a very small film. So I'm so excited for a blockbuster DC film.
Oh, man. And I just love how people are, you know, explaining it and reviewing it. I love the words they're using. I love the choices they're making. It just makes me way even more excited for this movie than I was before.
I'm stoked. Sucks I got to see it on the small screen. But anyway, last one comes from Eric Davis. Eric Davis wrote, "I'm so happy to report that Wonder Woman 84 is an absolute blast from start to finish. An exceptional compliment to the first film. It's stuffed with heart, hope, love, action, romance, and humor. Patty Jenkins, Gal Gadot, and the team deliver one of DC's best sequels. I was in tears when it ended."
Aww. Oh my gosh.
So that's kind of nice.
I just got goosebumps.
I know.
This is so exciting.
Heart, hope, love, action, romance, and humor. Pretty much everything you could say the movie should have, it did have.
Thank goodness. I'm so glad.
Great. And you said DC's best sequels.
What a great Christmas present.
I know. So, Shauna, these reviews change your opinion, up your excitement level?
My excitement level is way up.
Where was it before these?
I was excited because I appreciated the first movie. I really enjoyed it. And like one of your reviewers said, it was by far their favorite DC movie recently. And I have to 100% agree. And to hear everyone praising it. And like I like how one of the reviewers said ambitious, which sometimes that word...
Hugely ambitious from Jermaine Lucier.
Yeah. And sometimes that can be very negative, like when movies are ambitious and that they don't hit the mark. But the fact that this is ambitious and it seems like it hits the mark, I am so
very
stoked.
True, man. Sometimes you swing for the fences and you just completely whiff.
Yep.
It sounds like they swung for the fences, went really weird with it, and it seems to have stuck the landing.
Yeah. I'm so excited.
Guys, let us know in the comment section, do these change your opinion for Wonder Woman? What was your opinion before? What is your opinion now? Like, how's your excitement level? Are you going to be watching it in theaters or at home? Sound off in the comment section. We'd love to hear from you. As always, guys, next big nerd news story of the day. This sent a massive shockwave around the world of fandom. Alfred Molina returning as Doc Ock.
Oh, man.
In the new untitled Spider-Man 3 coming from the folks over at Sony and MCU. This report came from The Hollywood Reporter and just about every media outlet.
Oh, my God.
On the planet this week, Alfred Molina returning as Doc Ock. People thought maybe this was a possibility because of Jamie Foxx. We'll get into that in just a second. But this is an official announcement from the folks at Hollywood Reporter. Alfred Molina putting back on his metal arms and will reprise his role as the villainous Dr. Octopus. Official sources tell the Hollywood Reporter.
No, official.
I mean, Molina's involvement in the upcoming Spider-Man movie was, it was first rumored late last month.
Mm-hmm.
If you recall, when the actor had been spotted on set, that shit dropped back in November.
Wow.
And now it appears to be 100% confirmed. Honestly, Molina's involvement in the film cannot be overstated.
Yeah.
I mean, it ties together three generations. This officially ties together the three generations.
Absolutely.
Of the Spider-Man movie franchise. We know Jamie Foxx is returning as Electro,
which is Andrew Garfield.
He represents Andrew Garfield's amazing Spider-Man franchise, or Spider-Verse, we should say. Of course, Tom Holland, Spider-Man, going to be playing a very big role. He's going to be the forefront of the film for obvious reasons. And now Molina's Doc Ock brings in the Tobey Maguire Spider-Man universe into the sequel.
Oh, I'm so excited.
So it's almost a foregone conclusion. Now, no announcements have been made that Tobey or Garfield are going to be in it. I believe Tobey might have been spotted on the set already, but I think this is an absolute foregone conclusion.
Oh, it has to be.
You remember back in October, Jamie Foxx suggested in a very quickly deleted Instagram post that he suggested that three different Spider-Men could appear in the film. And
Oh, my gosh.
Yeah, if there was ever a doubt in your minds that Spider-Man would finally be giving us a live-action Spider-Verse, this appears to all but seal the deal.
And it also kind of hints to a multiverse in the sense of, I mean, didn't Doc Ock die?
Yeah.
Also, so did Jamie Foxx. He died as well, right?
Yep.
Like, so they're dead. So maybe it's just a multi...
And what this really is, this is just one of the pieces in the Sinister Six idea.
Because
Sinister Six, we haven't got any announcements for Sandman, but we've already seen Mysterio, Doc Ock, Vulture we've seen.
Uh-huh.
Electro. And who else is in Sinister Six? I know Sandman. Who else is in there? Anyway. Anyway, let us know in the comments. Yeah. Probably Green Goblin, maybe?
Oh, yeah,
anyway,
maybe.
That'd be neat. Anyway, yeah, let us know in the comment section, guys. How excited were you when you heard the news? Obviously, this isn't late-breaking news. I think this dropped on, like, Monday or Tuesday. But let us know. How excited were you? Where were you when you got the news? Probably at home in a Zoom meeting.
Like the rest of us.
Like the rest of the world. So send out the comment section, guys. Let us know what you think. In other Spider-Man news.
Oh, my gosh.
The rumor announcement came out this week that Charlie Cox's Daredevil will be returning to the screen.
Holy cow.
Also in the upcoming untitled Spider-Man 3 film. This is a rumor.
Rumor.
Don't watch this and tell us that, oh, you guys are getting your sources from idiots. I know. It's a rumor, but it's a really fun rumor that came out this week. And it's one that I think has a lot of merit that's worth talking about. The story came from us from CBR by way of a website called Murphy's Multiverse.
Okay.
Everybody is citing Murphy's Multiverse as the source for this thing. I don't know anything about Murphy's Multiverse, and they might just be like, we got this covered where everything's bullshit, but maybe it's legit.
Yeah.
Because everybody is citing Murphy's Multiverse on this. The report suggests that Charlie Cox's Daredevil will be joining Sony Pictures and Marvel Studios for the upcoming Spider-Man 3, and that the deal has been in place for months.
Yeah.
Said the deal was in place months ago.
I thought I heard something a few months ago, and I could be completely wrong or making this up, but I could have sworn that Charlie Cox slipped up and said something a few months back. So
I think he might have.
I remember this being talked about a few months ago. So I just can't remember where or what the source was, but yeah,
Well, I mean, it goes hand in hand with the Alfred Molina thing that he was joining as Doc Ock, and the news of this big announcement coming from... Oh, no. Forget I said that. I don't want to spoil anything for you guys. So, yeah. I don't know if you guys watched. I was kind of surprised, not to go off on a side note here. I was surprised they didn't say anything about Spider-Man and the Disney Investor Day conference. Not a thing was said about Spider-Man, I guess, because it's more of a Sony property.
That's true.
But I was expecting some. With all this news dropping about Spider-Man, I was hoping we'd get something, but we didn't. Little is known about the deal, or even if there is a fucking deal at this point, but what fans can speculate on. Uh-huh. And what I would like to expound on a little bit is Matt Murdock's role in the film.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, we know that after Spider-Man Far From Home, Peter Parker is now public enemy number one.
Yeah.
And what do people in trouble need more than
a lawyer.
Legal representation?
That's right.
And there you go. You got Matt Murdock as a lawyer, rooftop superhero. People love him. Fan favorite character, fan favorite actor. I was kind of hoping that maybe Jennifer Walters, She-Hulk, would be his attorney, because we already know we got casting for She-Hulk.
Yeah.
We've already heard from Kevin Feige that they're going to be tying the TV shows into the movies and then back into the TV shows. But with She-Hulk already happening, just give us Matt Murdock. This is a great way to introduce Charlie Cox back into the fold.
Right. Oh, that's great. And they're still not ruling out that Jennifer Walters doesn't come in. I mean, that could still possibly happen.
Maybe one's a prosecutor and one's a defense attorney.
Or she shows
that'd be awesome. As for Vincent D'Onofrio's Kingpin, well, we'll have to wait and see.
Oh.
But we do know that D'Onofrio wants to come back and play Kingpin. He said if he comes back, he will only be playing Kingpin.
Nice.
So I think that might be a foregone conclusion. What do you have to lose by bringing an Academy Award winning movie star into your fold? So nothing about D'Onofrio's Kingpin just yet. But I don't know. When you heard this news, did you think it was total bullshit, or did you kind of think that there's some possibilities? Because, I mean, honestly, with Spider-Man being public enemy number one, he's going to need a representation.
Right. I think there's strong
Nelson
possibility.
And Murdoch, man.
I think it's happening. I think
it's absolutely
just
happening.
Jump on board and say it.
I think it's the only cast member from the show that'll come over.
Yeah, for sure.
I think they will. If they ever do Punisher, they'll probably recast it outside of Bernthal. I don't think Foggy and the rest of the crew is going to come over, the actors, but I think Charlie Cox is a no-brainer.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Let us know in the comment section, guys. What do you think? Does this rumor hold any water in your mind? I bet by the time we release this show, it will be official, and this will be yesterday's news. So I don't know. Send off in the comment section, guys. Let us know what you think. Next big nerd news story of the week. All you fans of the amazing horror film franchise
Woo-hoo!
Alien, get excited. It came out from the Disney Plus Investors Conference that there's an all-new Alien television series coming to the FX network, and also Marvel Comics is going to launch their very first ever Alien comic book.
That's awesome.
The comic book's going to hit shelves in March. We're going to talk about both of things, the series and the comic. Let's talk about the series first, because how exciting is that?
Oh, it's so cool.
FX boss John Landgraf made official again, at the Disney Investor Day, that what has been out there for some time, there's been rumblings of this, the cable network is quickly moving to make a series based on the hit 20th Century Fox franchise Alien, with Fargo and Legion creator Noah Hawley stepping into the creator chair and also, I believe, as executive producer.
I didn't know Noah Hawley created or was a creator on Legion.
Yeah.
Oh, that's awesome.
That's his show, man. Huh. He was the showrunner of Legion.
Sweet.
Yeah, so... with the network in advanced talks with franchise helmer Ridley Scott to also be joining as executive producer. That's got me super duper excited.
Yeah.
For a number of reasons I'm going to get into in just a second. But yeah, so there was a tweet right after the Investor Day thing that came from the folks over at Disney and FX that said Alien is currently in development at FX Networks. The first TV series based on the classic film series is being helmed by Fargo and Legion's Noah Hawley. Expect a scary thrill ride set not too far in the future here on Earth.
Oh my God.
That's insanely interesting. Because as we know, the Weyland-Yutani Corporation, the Alien franchise, happens way the hell in the future. This says it's going to be set not too far in the future, and it's going to take place on Earth. So we're going to get aliens on Earth. I'm thinking it's some kind of prequel to the Weyland-Yutani Corporation. Maybe we get to see. So maybe Weyland-Yutani is a new startup company, and maybe they, you know, get some alien DNA somehow. I don't know how they're going to do it.
Yeah,
but that's really exciting.
So
that it takes place on Earth.
Many opportunities for this.
Though. And the fact that it's, I hope Noah Hawley doesn't get too weird with it. Like, I hope they lean very heavily into Ridley, because I mean, come on, if you guys haven't watched Raised by Wolves.
Oh my gosh.
Such a great show. And
beautiful.
I think Ridley directed two of the episodes. Mm-hmm. His son, I think, directed a couple of the episodes. He was the executive producer of that. It's phenomenal. If they can lean more Raised by Wolves and less Legion, I think I'd be a lot more happy.
Sure.
Hopefully that's the case.
Yeah.
The series is being billed, like I said, as the first alien story set on Earth and will blend the timeless horror of the original 1979 movie and the nonstop action of the 1986 James Cameron directed sequel. Because really, Alien and Aliens are like two very different
they
films.
They feel very different.
I mean, the first one is just, it's just one alien, first of all, spoiler alert. It's one alien. It's very dark. It's very kind of claustrophobic at times, whereas Aliens is a lot more widespread. There's a lot of stuff going on outside, large rooms, huge alien queens, huge hangars, and it's just nonstop action. Like, one's a horror movie, one's an action film. That can't be denied. So it's nice that they said that's going to be a nice little blend of the two.
This is great. This is going to be fantastic.
In a recent interview, right around Thanksgiving, Noah Hawley admitted he wasn't committed to the series yet, but had been in conversations about the Alien series in development. Well, now it's official from the tweet from Disney and the folks over at FX.
Amazing.
I don't know, man. It's mind-blowing to think that if maybe Ridley Scott gets to direct a couple episodes,
right?
That would be great.
It
wouldn't
be
shocking because he did direct, like we said, Raised by Wolves.
Right.
So he's not opposed to jumping in the director's chair for television series.
Absolutely.
Especially now that this is, you know, his own brainchild.
Oh my gosh, this is going to be great.
So cool, man.
I can't wait.
I hope he brings all the directors over from Raised by Wolves.
Right?
That's the series from Alien. Mm-hmm. There's also, as we mentioned earlier, a comic book series coming from Marvel. Marvel announced that they are also dipping their toes into the Alien franchise with a book coming out this March. The new Alien comic series is in the works over at Marvel with two heavy hitters at the helm. From DC, Mr. Philip Kennedy Johnson and Star Wars Darth Vader artist Salvador LaRocca.
Really?
So,
oh, man.
Philip Kennedy Johnson, if you're not a big DC fan, he's going to be launching the new Superman in 2021. He's taken over for... what's his name? Brian Michael Bendis.
Oh, Bendis, yeah.
It's Superman, so he's going to be pretty busy, and he's playing on both sides of the fence.
Yeah.
Over DC and at Marvel.
Man, that's going to be great.
It's pretty cool, man. Like, this is the first ever time that Marvel's done an Alien franchise. The series will be set. Basically, what they said from Marvel is that it's a bold take on the Alien mythology, as well as both new and classic characters from the movies, centering on a new character named Gabriel Cruz, who is described by the publisher as a Weyland-Yutani mercenary. So he's kind of a killer for hire.
Yeah.
My only guess is that he's going to get hired to go to a planet to kill somebody.
Yeah.
Lo and behold, the planet just happens to have aliens in it. And, of course, Weyland-Yutani probably knew that when they were going in there.
Right.
Let's go ahead and send that guy in, get him killed, get some DNA back. It's what they do.
Right.
Over at Weyland-Yutani, it's kind of like par for the course. Series writer Philip Kennedy Johnson said in an interview this week that, just as a reader and fan, I was excited as anyone when I heard the franchise was coming to Marvel. And when they asked me to write the launch, I was floored. I've been training my whole life for this gig without even knowing it. Ever since seeing Ridley Scott's Alien at way too young an age, I've been obsessed with the Xenomorph, the single most iconic representation of terror on film. I echo your statements there, Philip. I saw Alien at way too young an age, too. Scared the living shit out of me. I think I was like probably 7 or 6 when I saw Alien, and holy crap.
Scared the crap out of me.
So guys, Marvel's Alien hits comic book shelves this March. Put it on your pull list. And yeah, let us know. Are you excited? Are you going to pick it up? What's got you most excited? Or is it, you just not give a shit? We're curious. Let us know in the comment section. So final nerd news story of the day, Mandalorian Season 3. We officially have a release date for Season 3 of Mandalorian, and we're going to talk, A, about the release date, and also kind of our predictions on what to expect in Season 3 of Mandalorian. Well, I take a sip of my drink, Shauna. Season 2, how's it been living up to your expectations?
Oh, I'm enjoying Season 2 better than Season 1 at this point. I will admit that the first few episodes, I was like, okay, come on, what are we doing here? Because they were just very one-off storylines. They didn't loop anything back in like we were hoping right away.
Didn't even get Baby Yoda in the first episode,
right? So, but man, the last 3 episodes have been amazing.
They've been absolutely spectacular.
By far the best episodes for me.
Have been the last 3.
Yeah.
Which was the Ahsoka Tano episode, the Boba Fett episode, and then the one that happened this week, which was the...
bringing more back Boba Fett. Mayfield.
Oh yeah, that was so good. So,
I know.
I mean, season two definitely doubled down on the monsters and the fight scenes and the Baby Yoda eating things he shouldn't be eating at moments. You know, it was just more of everything we love here in season two, while also giving us some Star Wars firsts, including the appearance of Bo-Katan, the live action Ahsoka Tano, Boba Fett both masked and unmasked.
And we saw Mando unmasked last night.
He was pretty much... Oh, holy crap. Spoiler alert.
Sorry.
Moving right along.
Oh, who hasn't watched it yet?
I think you get a 24-hour grace period, and then all spoilers are off, because we got another episode next week coming out.
So exactly.
Fans should be allowed to talk spoilers.
By Sunday, it's been out for 48 hours, I think.
Holy crap. Mando took off his helmet, and Bill Burr saw him, and everybody saw him. Oh, my God. That was so good.
Yep.
So season two basically continued the story, the series storyline of Mando uniting with allies of his to try to be the best father figure he can to the most old and powerful little baby in fiction. Mando's quest in season two, I mean, it evolved from rescuing Grogu to escorting him to a Jedi for training, and then once more to having to rescue Grogu again. He's doing a lot of Grogu rescuing in this series. So what now, Shauna? What now happens? I mean, Mandalorian star Giancarlo Esposito, he already hinted in an interview way back that the series plans to keep flying for at least another 2 seasons.
Yeah.
You know, I told you we were going to announce the release date. Let's go ahead and do that. This week, we got the announcement that the release date for Season 3 is Christmas Day 2021.
I'll take it.
So they're going to be releasing on Christmas Day, which interestingly is a Saturday this year, and the show typically drops on Fridays. I wonder if Saturday is going to be their new release day. Or if they're just doing a Christmas Day just for the premiere of the first episode.
Shoot, why not just do it Friday, Christmas Eve of 2021? I mean, that Christmas Eve, that's a great time to sit down and watch them. Like, why didn't they
everybody
just do
can
that?
Stay home right before Santa comes down the chimney. And, like, everybody gets to watch Mandalorian. Right. And the next morning, they get to open up all their Baby Yoda toys.
Right.
Which you know are going to be everything that's under the tree.
Why did they do that? I don't know.
I don't know. Very, very interesting. So who do we think is going to be in the cast? Let's talk a little bit about what we might see in Season 3.
Yeah.
It's time for some fan speculation.
Uh-oh.
So far, the only confirmed names for Season 3 are Pedro Pascal. He's the only one who officially we know is going to be in Season 3.
Okay.
But just as Season 2 reintroduced characters like Cara Dune and Greef Karga, we're likely to see more than just a few returning characters,
sure.
I'm sure, including most likely Moff Gideon. That seems like a no-brainer.
Right.
But will we see Boba Fett in Season 3? Will we see Ahsoka returning in Season 3?
Oh, I hope so.
I don't think Boba Fett's making it out of the next season alive.
I don't think Boba Fett
think
is, but I think Ahsoka. I
don't think we're going to see Ahsoka again this season.
Yeah.
I think we very well could see her next season. I think Boba Fett's going to die in about 6 days from now. I think they're going to kill Boba Fett, man. I don't think he's making it out of Season 2 alive. Back to the Sarlacc pit with you, Boba. Dwayne Johnson has expressed interest in appearing on season 3.
Oh, that'd be awesome. Are you kidding me?
That would be awesome.
I don't know who he would play, but it doesn't matter. It's a new universe.
I would think he'd play a good guy, but I'd kind of like to see him play a bad guy.
Yeah, it's been a long
time. I don't think anybody would buy that. I mean, everybody's expressed interest. All he said is he expressed interest. It didn't say that Disney's courting him or anything.
Yeah, but if Dwayne The Rock Johnson expressed interest in something, you follow Dwayne The Rock Johnson.
You let him have a part. Just let him direct an episode.
I think he was the highest paid actor this year.
That doesn't surprise me one bit. I mean, there was only 4 movies, so.
That's true. That's a good point.
So let's talk about basic plot details. Let's fan theorize a little bit on some plot details for season 3. I think it's highly likely it's going to continue Mando's mission towards settling the child, Grogu, with
Grogu.
The Jedi. I don't think he's going to get him to a Jedi in tomorrow night's finale, or next week's finale.
He still hasn't retrieved him yet.
I think the finale is going to be retrieving him, or maybe he doesn't even retrieve him. I mean, that'd be even cooler. So while I think it's going to be the whole season, him still trying to get him to a Jedi for his final training, while also, of course, battling the escalating military force of Moff Gideon. So what else could we see? Is there a chance that we might see the first rumorings of the rise of the First Order?
Yeah.
I mean, is there even any likelihood that we might see the origins of Supreme Leader Snoke?
Or Thrawn, or...
I think we're definitely going to see Thrawn.
Yeah, but we're definitely for season 3. I don't think we're going to see him tomorrow.
No. I'm just talking about speculating on season 3.
And is it Ezra? I think his name is.
Yeah, yeah.
So, yeah, because that's who Ahsoka's looking for. Unless they bring that to
save
the Ahsoka show.
Save him for the Ahsoka show. Yeah.
I think
that's highly possible. They could theoretically use this opportunity to retcon the shit over at the Rise of Skywalker. And maybe Snoke wasn't some clone that freaking the Emperor made. Maybe they retcon it and show you how Emperor had a child. They could expand the universe. I don't think they will, but it's highly possible. The timeline, the time period is just right. Could you just imagine if they announced that the Emperor is going to just make his way? Because Giancarlo Esposito, Grand Moff Gideon is all, he is just a freaking Empire fan.
Yeah.
What if he somehow finds the Emperor? I doubt that's going to happen. But he would like it. He would very much like to sit around and have tea with the Emperor, I'm sure. Luke Skywalker, always a possibility.
Yeah.
We could see Luke Skywalker.
The time period works
perfectly.
Sebastian Stan, fan casting. Thanks, Boss Logic.
I don't think in this show you don't recast him, because Mark Hamill's still kicking. Mark Hamill can still play a young-looking him.
No way. So,
absolutely. Why not?
With the video mapping or something?
This is the de-aging technology.
That's
true. We basically saw in flashbacks in the new films him flashing back to when he was trying to train.
That's true. You're right.
We can do
saw young Kurt, or what's his face, in Guardians 2.
Yeah. It's expensive.
Yeah.
But you're saving all that money when you're shooting in the
Kurt Russell
stagecraft technology.
Yeah.
Use it on Luke Skywalker. It's a possibility we'll see Luke Skywalker just because the timing of it kind of works out. It's post Return of the Jedi, it's pre Force Awakens. He could pull off the perfect thing. And I don't think he recasts Luke Skywalker ever, in my opinion. I don't think you ever fucking. Mark Hamill is Luke Skywalker forever, unless you do some crazy Alderaan movie, go way back.
Okay, all right. That's cool.
So I don't know, guys. What do you think? Season 3, Mandalorian, what do you think are some of the definites? What do you think are some of the just crazy-ass concepts? What do you think about them launching on Christmas Day in 2021? Yeah. Send them in the comment section. Shauna, that's all we got.
Oh, my gosh. That's all? That was
what a week.
Lot. It was
this
a, lot
a long
digest.
Show, man.
And I still think there's some other things out there that we
what
missed.
What do you got?
But,
what do you got?
Oh, no. I don't know.
We'll move on. We'll save it for another show. So, guys, thanks a lot for watching this. If you're watching it on Chuckload of Comics or if you're watching it on the Mainframe Comic-Con YouTube channel, take a second, click the subscribe button, tell your friends, share it around on social media, say, look at these idiots. They don't know shit about shit. You got to watch these dumbasses. So, until next time. Have a fantastic week, guys. We will see you here next Sunday.
Bye-bye.